presents Inside New Zealand.
Kia ora, hello, I'm Neil Wacker. Welcome to Inside New Zealand, our very first program for 1995. It started as a little speck near Fiji and developed into a storm they termed a bomb. It engulfed over 30 yachts and turned last Queen's birthday weekend into a living hell for those caught in its path. The Air Force, Navy, Merchant Navy and National Rescue Coordination Centre became involved in what was to be the biggest sea rescue ever mounted in the South Pacific. In response to this incident, controversial maritime law changes have been enacted. So to the events of June 1994 and the story behind Pacific Rescue.
Mayday, mayday, mayday. Can you hear quartermaster calling?
June 1994, a rogue storm hits. And the largest sea rescue ever attempted in the South Pacific is about to be mobilised.
So you've had two knockdowns.
Just hanging on, John. Just hanging on.
Voluntary marine radio operators will work with the rescue centre to help 10 yachts in trouble. 21 people will be plucked from raging seas by two naval ships, two freighters and a fishing boat.
Hey, we just had a second knockdown, John. I don't know what to do.
The rogue cyclonic weather pattern that's causing this terror, destruction and, for some, tragedy is officially called a bomb. It'll rage for three grueling days and will affect over 40 vessels in all. It'll claim the lives of a family of three. This is the story of that ordeal, of the endurance of those who survived, and the heroism of those on land, in the air and at sea, who took part in Pacific Rescue. Yachting is a favourite pastime for thousands, millions around the world. Weekends on the harbour attract all sorts of sailors and all kinds of craft, who soon learn how punishing a wrong turn or instruction can be, how dangerous this so-called leisure pursuit can get. But when you've met that challenge, when you've felt it won with wind and sea, that's when interest can grow into passion. And that's when you might just be tempted to take time out for the ultimate sailing experience, an offshore blue water South Pacific cruise.
We had two guys sailing before we bought the boat, but at that stage I was crippled with RSI. I couldn't hold on, I couldn't move either arm. And so I was fairly scared of sailing.
And she's a clairvoyant, and we were, I forget where we were exactly in the States, all of a sudden she woke me up one morning and says, guess what, we're getting on a yacht and heading to New Zealand.
I started way back having a trailer sailor in the early 70s, then got involved with international boating. Finished up doing the Admiral's Cup in 1989 with Michael Fay. We did the one-ton worlds, Sydney Hobart. And in 86, I bought Silver Shadow.
He wanted the boat, so I said, well, why don't we build a boat big enough to live on, and then we can go places. And as we sort of, I guess it was just we played with the idea and then decided we wanted to build one strong enough to actually ocean cross with it.
We left on a three-year cruise, and that was 4.5 years ago, and we figured it was going to be another four and a half years before we got back. So you can see where once you get started, it's hard to stop.
At Kerikeri Marine Radio in the north of New Zealand, John and Maureen Cullen have for 10 years kept their cruising subscribers aware of weather conditions and supported those in trouble.
You've got to talk them through a problem and convince them that they can do it. And people will survive. Everybody will survive if they have a will to live and get confidence.
But when aircraft and ships have to be mobilised for search and rescue, the National Rescue Coordination Centre, on 24-hour standby at Aviation House near Wellington, is very quickly activated.
I never want to know the names of the people on board the yachts. I know there's four people there, and I know that one's injured, but John's got to deal with the personalities and the names of the people. I just want to know that there are four people there, and then when we rescue four people, that's four people.
It's from late April on, when the cyclones are gone, the prevailing winds and currents call blue water yachties to the Pacific, to Tonga, Fiji, Vanuatu, New Caledonia. It's become so popular, the Island Cruising Association has formed the New Zealand to Tonga Regatta as mutual support for the ever-growing fleets. It's not a race, it's a pleasure cruise. And a fleet of 34 is scheduled to leave late May, a week before New Zealand's Queen's Birthday holiday weekend. Before departure, all boats and crews are cleared by customs and asked to fill in a 10-minute form, detailing personnel, safety equipment, destination and schedule. And these forms are passed on to the rescue centre. New Zealand registered boats must also pass a Category 1 safety inspection, requiring, among other things, appropriate and reliable life rafts, emergency beacons and UHF and VHF radios. Foreign registered boats are not, in 1994, required to meet these standards. Bad weather conditions offshore cause cancellation of the official start, and regatta skippers are left to determine their own departure times. Not all the yachts sailing in the region are part of the regatta. Not all the regatta boats have chosen to depart from Auckland, and there are several boats which, for a range of unforeseen reasons, delay their final departure. It's these yachts, sailing well behind the main regatta fleet, which will find themselves most exposed to the storm. Quartermaster, left on schedule from Whangaparoa. The lost shaft and propeller have forced it back to port. It departs with skipper Bob Rimmer, his wife Marie and her son James some 5 days later. Ramtha, a catamaran from Australia crewed by Bill and Robin Forbes, left on time. But temporary steering problems set them back, so they too lag behind the main fleet.
We had reasonable sailing. You had swells, you know, 1 to 2 metres. Winds were even down to 15 knots at times, and, you know, it had gone round to the southeast and the east, and I'm saying, hey, we're in the southeast trades, we're there.
American couple Dana and Paula Dinius, who are not part of the regatta, are heading for Fiji, so take their 45-footer Destiny on a more northerly course.
And one of the things we don't have to do as cruisers is leave in a 40-knot blow. So we set it out, and come Monday, the winds abated. It looked good, other than very sloppy seas. We really had a very good trip.
32-foot Sophia is not part of the regatta either. Although they plan to rendezvous with regatta friends in Tonga, Keith Levy and Ursula Schmidt have waited for a more inviting weather window. They eventually set sail 3 days after the main fleet.
When we sailed off from Auckland on the 31st of May, I didn't have a cent. Everything was in Sophia.
Before leaving, Keith's given his spare distress flares to sister ship Pilot, also bound for Tonga. For over 20 years, Pilot's been home to Americans Greg Forbes and Barbara Parks. Being US registered, so not obliged to comply with New Zealand's Category 1 safety standards, they've left from Auckland's West Haven Marina with no working radio and no locator beacon.
We've always been low-budget cruisers, and once again, we put our money and our effort into the boat and basically taking care of ourselves.
Heartlight, another catamaran, leaves on time but gets into heavy seas and is forced to continue north. Darrell and Deviana Wheeler sailed to New Zealand from Florida, and for the last 4 years, they've enjoyed the South Pacific cruising grounds.
My wife started moving into what I call these altered states of consciousness. And now I'm used to seeing her do that when she's in meditation, but she was doing it like when in her normal states. And she all of a sudden said to me, well, we're heading towards a vortex and it's going to disturb the weather patterns.
Huge.
So you better
be prepared.
Yeah, that was the words. And I felt like this chill go up my backside.
The sleek racing cruiser Silver Shadow is the only yacht that leaves from Wellington, a day after the main fleet. But skipper Peter O'Neill and his crew of three, including his son, are confident their extra speed will soon see them bridge the gap.
We had a great ride all the way up the coast. We got winds up to 30, 40 knots, no problem, but The boat was off the wind, so the boat was sailing very comfortably, and we were making great progress. In fact, we were doing something like 200 miles a day.
Further south, skipper John Hillhorst, his wife Kath Gilmore, and three other crew leave Christchurch on Waikiki 2, the same day as the main fleet, but 5 days later than they'd planned, and hit a southerly storm.
Whammo, we got hit by this gust in good southerly fashion. We then had about 2 days where we had winds in excess of 50 knots, hovering around in excess of 50 knots.
From Fiji, the freighter Tuitakau 3, skippered by Jim Hebden, leaves on schedule for its regular trip south to Auckland.
I said, oh, the weather looks good, we should be there on time, which wasn't really the correct thing to do. And we sailed from Latoga and it was beautiful conditions, it was all right. Clear weather forecast, everything looked good.
The sailing schedule of HMNZS Monowai, the Navy's hydrographic survey ship, has been somewhat altered by a Mercy mission back to Raoul Island. They've returned to assist a Department of Conservation officer with a severely gashed leg.
Well, over Queen's birthday weekend, we were actually making our way north from Raoul Island towards Tonga at the start of a deployment to the South Pacific as part of our annual deployment for routine survey work around the Pacific.
1 week into the regatta, these are the vessels randomly selected by circumstance to feel the full force of the bomb. The rogue weather pattern starting to form in the northwest corner. John Cullen had planned to be out in a boat himself over the long weekend. He decides to stay with Maureen instead, just in case, given the looming weather conditions and signs of possible trouble.
Friday evening was the first time we really knew that it was heading our way and it was supposed to be going to cross the path of the regatta fleet. And we were told then that, okay, it was going to be round about Saturday, that it would be close to us and we would have fairly strong winds.
Sophia, Kiri Kiri, copy, Keith.
What's in store for the next 24?
East-south-easterlies I've got for you here, 20, 25 and 30 knots. I'd be a bit inclined to slow down rather than run straight on into it, over.
Okay, John, that's fine, that's exactly what we'll do.
Just got bigger and bigger, the winds got stronger and stronger, but everything was fine. You know, so, you know, I'd been in 50 knots before and big seas, and you know, I wasn't really expecting any major change.
Kiri Kiri, Silver Shadow,
yes, Roger, loud and clear, go ahead.
Yes, Murray, this evening, yeah, everything's fine, having quite a pleasant sail at the moment. What have you got for us?
Okay, well, I think you should slow down. The conditions for you, if you continue on your present path, you're heading straight into it. If you want to take some evasive action, you might like to make a little bit to the west, over.
We'd caught up with the last boats in the fleet, but that's when we saw the low and we decided to go west.
All day Thursday and Thursday night, Silver Shadow and Quartermaster were off of our port and starboard rear quarter of our boat. We saw their lights all evening. We'd heard them talking on the radio. So we slowed down Friday morning and they passed us.
The severe depression, soon to develop into a bomb, continues southeast, traveling at over 400 miles per day. And it's starting to make itself known to destiny.
We were getting pooped occasionally, you know, but that's something
not
that's happened to us
at that
before.
Point.
So it wasn't until we actually got up into the high 60s that and low 70s that I realized that we were in what I thought was a hurricane, a cyclone.
And all the indications were there that it was a cyclone, which was out of season. And normally the odd ones, if you look back, the odd ones out of season, normally the bad fellas.
The extra energetics of the wind, we were getting the development of a lot of thunderstorm activity. It was over sea temperatures that were about 22 degrees. Not a tropical condition. This was not a tropical cyclone in that sense of the word.
To get out of calling it a cyclone and having it out of season, it was called a severe depression. So you can put what name you want to it. It was a circular motion depression, and it was a severe one, which is a cyclone to me, but, you know, everybody to their own.
I mean, in its development, it was not a tropical cyclone, which requires waters of, say, 28 degrees and light and variable winds aloft. Here again, we had moderate sea surface temperatures and this strong jet coming around. These things energized that storm so that by midnight, it was a very intense storm.
The weather forecasting was still giving us a higher barometer reading than I was getting, and there was no warning out, so we weren't unduly concerned at that stage.
It was very black anyway out there, just very black, but it was, the lightning was approaching. I believe we went right through the center because of this lightning show. It was just amazing. And as it approached us, you could just see it coming directly. And then it was on us, and it was just all over us. And you could feel it as it cracked and just go through your body.
We had 85 knots of wind, and it really wasn't a wind. It was a mist. It was really an intriguing. One of the things that we talked about later, we didn't discuss it at the time, but there was a real presence there. There was an evil there that we felt. The wind would come in from the right or the left and swirl up in front of us in a big mist, and then it would exit. And it might exit forward. It might exit over my shoulder. It wasn't a consistent type of wind.
Yeah, it was.
And with the lightning cracking
ominous
all around us, it was We can only describe it as a real evil.
We went right through the middle and we got typical vortex conditions. The sky cleared, we got a confused swell with a predominant southeasterly, a big fella running through. And the birds were in the middle, you know, they got pulled in into the eye of it. And then she went through and the barometer took off on a rise and the wind took off at the same time from the southeast.
Now the top edge of the storm has found the tail enders of the regatta yachts who left Auckland on time. Boats like Arosa and Carinya.
You're just sitting there. I was actually just sitting there thinking how well the boat handled. About 30 seconds later, there was this gigantic roar. And you just know the boat's going over. It just goes. The whole mast goes right over. We went down to about 120 degrees. You think that this is it. But you don't have time really for anything else. I mean, I had no sensation of being in the water. I had a safety harness on, but I must have been over the side. We lost winch handles, we lost seat squabs. But the next thing is the boat's back up, and I was jerked back into the cockpit.
It was like really just huge mountains with snow everywhere. It looked like you could ski everywhere. It was just foam and...
It was white.
Just so much white.
Every day, just putting your head up and just looking at all that water. I was getting to the stage, I was ready to scream. I just had that...
Had enough,
and that continual bang, bang, slop, clang.
I actually said goodbye to her. You know, I was concerned that maybe there wouldn't be time. And she didn't accept that too well. She was...
He said it twice with a bit of time in between, but the first time he said it, he basically just, what he said was, I love you, and I knew he was saying goodbye. And I was mad. Don't you say that, you know, we got a job to do and we're doing it now, keep steering.
The wind's just howling and it just doesn't stop, and you're just shouting at it to stop, and it doesn't. It just keeps on going, and you think, you get a forecast that says there's another day and a half of this. How can I get through another night?
I could see they were over the top of our mast height, which is 65 feet off of the water. And I just said, oh, you know, and realizing just what I was looking at there. And I said, I got to go put in a pan. I have to let somebody know where we are and the situations that we're in out here.
Kiri, go ahead with your pan, over.
Okay, where are you? A pan call signals urgency. It's one step below a Mayday distress call and indicates the caller has a very urgent message concerning their safety.
We've had 70 plus out to hold. The seas are mountainous. Roger, I copy, Destiny. Is all well with you, over? Roger, okay, well, we'll stay on standby. Just give us a call if you've got any problems, over.
Destiny is a big yacht, and minutes after her pan call, she'll be in even bigger trouble.
The wave that took us was pretty much the same start. It just, we were sucked up in it. The air hit us, the seas engulfed us, but there was a difference in that we hung up in the sea. I said to myself, gee, this is different. Something's different here. And when the bow finally came out, there was just air under us. I said to her, we're on our way.
So we both just watched as the bow just went like this.
I remember becoming weightless, where I was just like floating off the deck when something drops out from under you, onto the wheel.
He was standing behind the wheel.
And when we came out of that wave, it was just a free fall to the bottom. And
so it pitch pulled.
I remember hitting, because I remember going, oof, type of thing, but as far as what the boat did, I don't know. We didn't run out of air, either one of us.
And then I felt like I was sort of in a washing machine, because we pitch pulled and then we rolled. And I think it was in the roll that I was feeling, you know, the agitation of the water pulling me back up.
We know we rolled because the mast itself was actually bent right around the boat and came up on the other side. It went off the starboard and went under the boat and came up on the port side. So there had to be a very quick flip and then a very strong roll. To bend a mast like that, it had to be a very fast roll. And so you tend to look at the other person, and in that instant, there's a lot of things said in that instant. Are you okay? You know, is the boat still afloat? And we, you know, once we both recognized we were all right, then I tried to move and I couldn't, and I couldn't drag myself, and I couldn't sit up, and I mean I was in excruciating pain, and so I told her, I said, I'm broke.
I came up with the hacksaw.
Hacksaw and the E-perb, the 406 E-perb, which, you know, if there's any one piece of gear on board that didn't fail, that's it.
Once switched on, an E-perb, an electronic position indicating radio beacon, sends its signal to a satellite which relays it to a land station. In this case, a commercial aircraft picks it up first, and so the rescue center is activated.
406 beacon gives us a lot of information. Apart from giving us a very accurate position, it also tells us the identity of the vessel. So we knew it was from Destiny. We knew the Pan call was from Destiny.
The New Zealand Air Force is called in, and an Orion aircraft is dispatched to pinpoint Destiny's location and ascertain the condition of yacht and crew.
It took us a couple of hours to get into the search area, and on descent into there, it was conditions were far worse than had been forecast at the time. We'd had a bit of a chat to Kerikeri Radio on the way up.
Now on 24-hour alert, Kerikeri has cleared the air for regular scheduled radio reports and urgent calls only. While John's working with the Orion, he gets a call from Quartermaster, seeking advice on how to best handle the storm.
Royal Island, their direct forecast.
Your choice is to hove to where you are, or run with it. Just sort out whatever's the most comfortable for you. You really don't have a choice, and sort out whichever way you're going to sit the best to be able to sustain the stronger conditions, because you're going to be looking at, I don't know, I hope you don't get what the other boat's got, but I guess you've got to be prepared. They've had 70 knots of wind. Just prepare yourself for the worst, over.
Okay, John, any chance of us heading slightly out of it by going northwest?
Unfortunately, not very much. The distance you'll cover won't be much, but anything at all you do will help, over.
Many thanks, John.
We sort of descended out of cloud and heavy rain and came out at about 1,000 feet, and the waves were such, and there was enough spume around to really confuse the visual picture. It didn't look like we were at 1,000 feet.
Destiny's mast is down and Dana's leg's been broken at the hip. Paula has to get him below deck.
Either I die up here or I get below. Now, what's it going to be?
It was sort of that condition at that point. I mean, so he just basically gritted his teeth.
Bit hard moved is what it
meant. And I grabbed his legs.
It took us about 3 passes to actually find the Destiny then. But it was pretty rugged. We had 80 knots of wind down at low level, and we were getting knocked around quite severely.
As soon as we started off, we went to the Met Office and asked them to give us an update on the weather. But at that stage, we didn't realise just how bad it was. And in fact, it wasn't until the Orion got into the area and came back and said, it's a state 9C, and the 70 knots on the surface, we started to think, golly gosh, we've got a really big storm here.
So about this time, I was standing there, and I hear, Destiny, Destiny. I looked around, and I thought, where's that coming from? Somebody's calling us.
Destiny, Kiwi 315.
But I followed the sound, and it was a VHF.
Destiny, Kiwi 315.
And it was the Orions. And I thought, oh my God, you know? Because such a short period of time had gone by.
Yeah, it was about 2 hours after we'd rolled.
Destiny, Kiwi 315, do you copy me now?
Yes, I do, thank you.
Okay, Paula, I have a doctor on board my aircraft. Do you need any advice from him, over?
Well, I got Dana down inside because he was going into shock. I gave him a Tylenol 3. I gave him 1.5 of those for the pain. He seems to be lucid and adequate, I guess. Is there anything I should try and do for him?
Roger, Paula, this is the doctor. What time did the injury occur? Over.
Oh dear. Time. maybe 3 hours ago.
The value of that calm voice to come aboard, you're linked to the outside. All of a sudden, you're not alone out there in the middle of nowhere, getting hell kicked out of you.
They say, well, we have a message from your mother. And, you know, the message was to hang in there, it'll be okay. And it was like, oh, God, my thinking was my poor mom, you know.
Paula's next problem, with Dana incapacitated and now in shock, is the broken mast. It's threatening to pound a hole in Destiny's hull.
We were pretty conscious of the fact that the mast was bashing into the side of the boat and a fiberglass boat, that it wasn't going to take long until the mast came through.
It had started turning into almost a dull sound from that bang. It was kind of almost like a squishy sound, pulverizing sound. And then just before daylight, the timbers, you could hear timber cracking in those spots that it was hitting. And that was so hard to sit and listen to all night. It was just, you just felt it's just a matter of time.
Not far away, the freighter Tui Thakau picks up the radio contact between the Orion and Destiny and offers to help.
The Orion called me back and they said, yeah, we're to go in for the rescue. And they said, can you make best speed? And the problem with that, of course, I'm in a pickle as well. I mean, it's bad conditions even for a big ship.
Tui Kakao, QB 315, Channel 16, over.
Yeah, QB 315. I just wondered if you could give me an indication what sort of weather conditions you're getting down there.
It's probably about sea state 9 or so, 4 to 5 meter swells. And I would guess it's 60 knots plus.
I'm light ship and I'm struggling a bit myself. I'm just managing to hold the course without broaching too. The barometer's at 983 now, but still falling.
The chief officer had finished his 4-8 watch on the bridge, and he just got into the mess room, and he got thrown across the mess room with another guy who weighed about 18 stone, the ship's fitter, and the two of them took a skate across the mess room, and the chief officer broke his leg.
Now the catamaran Heartlight has joined quartermaster in seeking advice from Kerry.
Roger, Heartline, go ahead.
Is there any chance this thing is lessening up in the near future, over?
I'm afraid I don't see much easing until at the earliest noon tomorrow, over.
Okay, well, we'll just try to hang in here. We're just always on the lookout for broaching because we're coming down these waves pretty fast, over.
In 16,000 miles of ocean crossing, I've never steered the boat.
In
it's
seas.
always, you know, always when you come into port, but when you cross the ocean, you put on autopilot because it steers better than you can ever steer.
I mean, he can reverse park like nobody's business, but he has never actually taken it off of autopilot ever at sea.
So that became my biggest concern. What happens if I have to start steering this boat down these waves?
What he actually said is if I have to steer the boat, we can all just kiss our ass goodbye.
Quartermaster Kerry, copy, Bob?
Yeah, quartermaster hearing you, boy. We've just had a real bouncer.
What you've got, unfortunately, look as if it's going to continue. You're right in the path of the system, and there's little you can do about it. So good luck with it there, Bob. We'll be thinking of you. We will be on air all night if there's any problems. Over.
Okay, thank you, John.
We weren't going to be able to rescue the people off the Destiny until first light the next day. At that stage, we realised that we were going to need another aircraft if we were going to have an aircraft up there to help the Tui Kakao first of all find the yacht and then keep an eye on the whole thing. So Steve went back at that stage back to Auckland, and we said we will probably need another airplane. And Auckland said we have one available, but we only have one more.
The now raging storm, this bomb at sea, also causes real problems for the Orion, especially when it flies low.
We could actually feel the waves go underneath us because of the size of the waves and the amount of wind that was going underneath. We were at lower level. A few of our guys are cooked down the back as well, which doesn't help things.
Made sure wherever I was that I had a handhold. I was just on the handholds all the time because you never knew when you were going over.
You had no warning at all. It would just be a giant kablam, and then all heck would break loose.
We go over again with one of these. I don't know. I wish I could get, I don't know, I'll go out and do what I can do, and then I'll come back and give you a call. And this is, who do I call? Over.
You can call us anything you want. My name is Bruce, or Mike is my tactical coordinator at the back, or you can just call us Kiwi or whatever you like.
I can remember at one point feeling
quite anxious for her. And it was from then on that I realised how serious their plight was and everyone out there. So, yeah, hearing their voice, hearing their tone of voice was very important.
Yeah, mayday, mayday, mayday. Kenny here. Quartermaster calling. Yeah, mayday, mayday, mayday. Kenny here. Quartermaster calling.
Quartermaster, Kiri Kiri, I copy. What's your problems, over?
Yeah, this is Quartermaster. We've just been rolled. Checking everything now. Windows are all still in. We had an earlier accident with Maria's got a big cut over her eye.
Quartermaster's distress call for immediate help is hampered by not knowing their current position. In the northwest, the Tui Thakau has had to heave to and wait until daylight to attempt its rescue of destiny. The second Orion's only just been dispatched from Auckland. The first Orion's running low on fuel and is due to fly onto Fiji as soon as it's been relieved. Meanwhile, they must keep faith with destiny and stay in touch with Paula.
She kept asking us how long it was to first light, and we kept telling her. I think we kept sort of telling her it was only half an hour for several hours, I suppose.
It was about 3 o'clock when they felt that the mast was going to actually start breaking the boat up. She suddenly picked up again, and there was a lot of anxiety there. She actually called us up rather than us initiating the communications, and yeah, it got worrying. It was stressful.
At Kerikeri, John and Maureen maintain an around-the-clock vigil, taking hourly reports from each yacht. Emergency calls are starting to mount. The next is from Heartlight.
Kerikeri, loud and clear, go ahead.
I just want to give you our position. We can knock down, we're still upright, but we came down way pretty hard.
You've got about 80 knots of wind at the present moment, over.
Yeah, well, we got a steady 65, 70 gusts into 80, over.
Okay, we'll look for your call every hour. Okay, good luck there, over.
Thank you, John. Heartlight clear.
You can imagine, this is a catamaran. It's moving down, all of a sudden starts to stand up on one hull and moves up about 60 degrees and is moving up and starts to careen down the wave on one hull, and she flies out of the chair. I fly out on top of her. I mean, she smashes into the wall. I smash in on top of her. And as the thing is going up, it's almost like this hand, this like this invisible hand comes down all of a sudden and just pushes her back down. And everything in the boat trashes.
Everyone's battling extremely rough seas, but it's the rogue wave, the totally unexpected 50 to 60 foot wall of water that's the most punishing. Greg and Barbara on pilot have already met more than one.
We heard another one coming, and this one just rolled us right on over. And there wasn't really anything violent about it, except the fact that you could hear this thing coming again, another one of these big rumbling breakers.
I was lying down on my bunk. I went right over. I'd never moved. All the stuff wound up on top of me, but mostly Greg. But it was a very smooth and quick roll. Then we were right again and scrambling around, trying to get ready to go up on deck and see what kind of a mess was up there. Our dinghy was also our life raft. It had full flotation so that it was unsinkable, but it was in two pieces and stacked up on deck, and we lashed the two pieces together and then we lashed it on deck. It was still there fine, but our mast was in an S shape.
I had to get rid of the thing because at that point our boat was our life raft, was our lifeboat, and had to try to keep it floating at all costs, because I couldn't imagine even getting into a life raft or any type of a lifeboat in those conditions. I don't think anybody could have survived in a life raft.
Quartermaster Kerry Kerry, Roger, you're loud and clear, go ahead.
Hey, we just had a second knockdown, John. I don't know what to do.
No, there's not much you can do. How's everybody on board? Has anybody heard at all, over?
No, we're just hanging on, John. Just hanging on.
Now, a half loose 100-pound dinghy banging against the side of Heartlight is adding to Deviana and Daryl's problems.
I've got to get out there and cut that dinghy loose, but of course I can't leave the wheel, so who does that leave? My son. And I'm sitting there thinking, my God, if he goes out there and another wave comes and takes him off.
We realized if we were in outside steering, there wouldn't be anybody on that boat. That's what my son had to go out into.
And he says, I've been really thinking about this. He says, I'm expendable. Mm-hmm. And of course, that really hits you right in the heart.
He said, I don't want to go. I don't want to go if I can't see your eyes.
That's what it was. I don't want to go if I can't see your eyes. And I heard her respond back, don't worry. If you go in, I'll jump in with you.
No, I said, I will follow you.
And so I'm sitting here now on the helm saying, now we're not talking about my son, because I know when she says something like that, that's serious. We're talking about my wife, and the two most precious things in my life could be in that water. Now, that's what I'm talking about, abject terror.
And all of a sudden, this huge wave hits the boat, and the boat goes, whang! And that's when he started screaming at me, is he still there? Is he still there? We hear this, F you!
What many boats are experiencing now is known as severe knockdowns, where the force of the wind and a wave knocks you over until your mast is underwater. But your keel, which is loaded with tons of lead, conspires with the force of gravity to snap your boat upright again. Unless, like Sophia, you go the full 360 degrees.
All of a sudden, we got hit by a wave and turned upside down. And I was just realizing, I opened my eyes and I was covered with some of the things. I was lying there on the ceiling, seeing our new carpet, which we put in before we left. And, well, yeah, what was it doing up there? And I saw that the companionway was in a strange angle, and I realized that we've been upside down. And I asked Keith if he was all right, and I just heard a few whispers. He really hurt his back badly. Kerry Kerry radio was still on the skate, so I tried to get the mayday call through, but I couldn't do that because, as we discovered later on, the mast was gone.
Sophia, Kerry Kerry radio calling. Do you copy? Over.
So, well, she had it all under control, and I was sort of at this stage.
Oh, he was like mad. He was asking, what's happening? Where are we? What are we doing? Where's the water coming from? He always asked those questions, and I told him that we've been on the way to Tonga, that we have been rolled, and that we've been through a big, that we are in a big storm. And I told him that he should turn the EPIRB on because I was too nervous to read the instructions.
At 4 minutes past two on Sunday morning, the 5th of June, Maureen takes what is to be the last transmission from Bob Rimmer on Quartermaster.
Everybody coping inside, over.
We're just lying down where we can.
Roger, yep, we don't mind. We're just sitting here waiting for the calls and thinking about Joel out there.
Thank you very, very much.
Oh, you're welcome, yeah. Keep your chin up, it's going to win.
The racing cruiser Silver Shadow has made what they'd thought was excellent progress. Having left a day late and from Wellington, they've now caught up with the tail enders. But in their eagerness to join the regatta, they've sailed right into the storm.
We heard an enormous roar. We were going along at about 8.5 knots, and we heard a big roar. And I was in my bunk near the nav, and next minute it was like a truck hitting the side of the boat. It just hit us, picked us up, and then threw us down. And we went to about 160 degree, and at that stage we actually lost our mast. Now, at this stage, the storm was actually getting worse, and we were getting knocked. And I was a bit worried about people being on deck, so we all got back down below after got rid of the mast. And I was about to, I said to the guys, I said, OK, what else can we do? And let's assess the situation. Right, tomorrow morning, we'll put a jury rig up. We had a spinnaker pole, and we've got enough fuel. We'll sail off to Tonga, and then we'll carry on from there. And effect repairs. But just as I was about to make a cup of coffee for the guys, we got hit, and I heard it coming, we got hit by an enormous wave that just went right over top of us and turned us 360. I can assure you, you don't want to be in the 360 Club. So he got me onto a bunk and I said, John, I think I've broken something. I knew I'd broken something because I could feel the bones actually grating against each other. And we actually sat there for a few moments and then Murray said, hey, we've lost our life raft. Now, our life raft was tied to the deck through stainless steel bolts and a couple of those had broken. In that 360, so we'd lost the life raft. I then said to the guys, hey, I think it's time we put the EPIRB off. I didn't actually know the extent of my injuries. The boys had started pumping panadine into me. I could have taken morphine, but I didn't want to do that because that makes you sleepy, and as skipper, I wanted to be aware of what I was about. And John and the guys had then got me behind a lee cloth in the bunk on the port side, and actually put cushions over me and tied me into that bunk. And that's where I stayed for probably the next 36 hours until we were rescued. I get claustrophobia, and at times, I tell you what, that was pretty terrifying.
The rescue centres had an unidentified EPIRB signal for 4 hours now. They suspect it's Sophia, but can't confirm it, till duty officer Bill Sommer finds another aircraft to check it out.
Contacted the captain of the Orion that was holding over the top of Destiny and said, we've got this beacon, it's about 200 odd miles to the south, can you go down and have a look? And the captain made the decision and said, no, I'm not too happy about leaving the people overnight, they're in distress condition, they're not in good shape, I want to stay. And we accepted that straight off.
The rescue coordinators have no choice. They must wait till morning for a C-130 Hercules to fly into the rescue area and locate the mystery beacon. Meanwhile, Bill links up with John at Kerikeri to further investigate its source.
Going through their position reports that had been getting in, they worked out that the highest probability for that beacon was Sophia. No contact with Sophia at that stage. They'd lost HF comms with it, so that was the most likely target. Not long after that, they got another beacon.
4 a.m. Sunday, the Monowise checking out a pan-pan call from the U.S. registered Mary T, relayed by quartermaster some hours before, when suddenly and against all reason, the night sky is ablaze.
What we saw, or what we thought we saw, was a flare. We're all of us standing on the bridge. The captain had retired by that stage and the off-going officer watch had gone. And we're just looking forward, and then the sky just lit up. It was very bright.
Suddenly, all the decks lit up. I could just see out of the corner of my eyes there was all this light around us.
We might be getting some lightning because we were going into a storm, and then the sky just lit up, and we could see for miles. And it was really quite strange.
And about 100 feet above us in low cloud, there was this great big ball of light. It wasn't a defined light like that. It was just a glowing mass of white light with just a tinge of sort of orange.
And I was called to the bridge. Although the description that I was given didn't sound very much like a normal safety flare, and for it to be white, that's not the normal distress type colour. So I mulled it over and discussed it with the officer of the watch and decided that we couldn't just ignore it. So I put a call out on VHF.
Remtha responds to that call.
Bill was really, and he said, you know, I wouldn't mind being taken off here. And I actually said to the captain, okay, my husband's just said he wouldn't mind being taken off. And that's when he said to me, well, look, we are on our way to a vessel in distress. And I just said, well, message understood. We are coping, but we'd at least like you to take note of our position. And that's when he actually said that he would at least give our position to the Wellington Rescue Centre.
Shortly after that, Ramtha called up again and said that they'd lost their steering, their mainsail, or the small bit of sail they had set up, had blown out, that they'd almost capsized, and they requested to be taken off.
We came very close. That's probably the closest we've ever come to capsizing.
And that's
being
when
dark,
I,
yeah. And because yeah. of so much water around, it was I couldn't tell you what degrees we went to. Yeah. All this stuff came out. Everything came out for the first time.
I told them that any assistance I was able to give would be hazardous to life and limb.
The Monowai shelters Remtha till daybreak. Meanwhile, to the south, Hotlight checks in with Maureen at Kerikeri.
Maureen at Hotlight at 2807 south.
Oh, surfing down huge seas. Just think what stories you're about to tell her when you get ashore again with it all.
This boat was careening down the waves. You've seen these pictures of stunt cars where they go up on two wheels and go down. Well, we were careening down the waves just like this. And it was like in slow motion. I was on the floor now. My son was standing straight up on the windows. Deviana was thrown out onto the floor. And we're down and I hear Deviana in the background yell, "She's found her spot." And then all of a sudden, the boat came down and right side up.
She went over. But she didn't go over upside down. She went over and came back and landed upright.
And that was her death row. Mm-hmm. All the engines were stuffed because they were filled up with water. All of the drogue lines had wrapped all of her propellers and wrapped her rudders. The force of it had cracked a portion of the hull. And there we sat, and I lashed the wheel over, and now we were sitting sideways in these huge seas.
So I brought the children to me, and I have children, they're in their 30s and later, but they're still my children. And I brought them, and I told them I wanted them close, and I had Daryl, and we got into a tight-knit circle at the base of the door, and I told them that because we were sideways into the seas, that we, not having any control, if the boat at that point was to go over, or if the windows were to break and she filled with water, what I wanted them to do was to be very centered, and I wanted them to understand that when they were born into this world, that when they were in the womb, they were living in salt water, and the joy they had when they were in their mother, and that the DNA structure of the body has its own living understanding, and when you release your consciousness from it, it actually goes into a joy frequency. It's free, and it goes back into mother. And so that when we left, we'd open the door and we would swim together, and that it would just be like a little bit of cold water, chuck the lungs just a little bit, but that it wouldn't be painful, and that we would just move, and that we'd move through this vortex energy, and it would be all right.
When Hotlight fails to make its next scheduled radio report, John gets worried. He talks it through with the rescue center.
Hotlight hasn't checked in now, but bloody locality as the quartermaster forward, and bugger all. And they haven't come up. I've been calling and calling them, and they've been bloody reliable right up till now. And they're on the hour every hour, so it's 20 minutes overdue on their time.
Destiny, Hotlight, Sophia, Silver Shadow, Ramtha, and Quartermaster have all activated their beacons. And now, 6:30 a.m., Sunday, 5 June, Tui Thakau is ready to meet with Destiny.
Yeah, daybreak, 6:30. I said, as soon as I get a twilight, I'll make a run for it. And by then, I'd move the ship into a southeast position. I was southeast of the yacht, and they were setting to the north still. And I came through wanting it on my starboard side in her port. And the first time I misjudged it.
It just seemed this huge ship was coming at me, and I just thought, oh God, you know, how is this ever gonna go down? At that point, our boat just...
I hear this scream, so you know, oh my God, oh my God, oh my gosh. He says, Dana, get up here.
And I came through very close, and then the last minute I said, no, I've got to get out of this, we'll abort it. And I went full ahead on both engines, and as I'm coming past the yacht, I had to kick that engine astern and give maximum on the other engine to spin around. So I was going full ahead on the port, full astern on the starboard, and a bow thrust, and cutting away from the yacht before I blew on top of it. And I don't think it gave them much confidence.
On the first pass, it didn't go well. Our boat didn't react well, and the Tui got caught in a big swell, and it was really heeling bad. And so as we went by her, we were getting sucked up under her stern into the prop wash, and I was just looking straight up at this huge ship as I was getting sucked right into her props. You could see the ship starting to just turn off, stern away from us. And it was just amazing watching it. And so then he made another pass. And in between the passes, I came down and I just said, I just don't know how this is going to happen, you know.
She had some serious doubts if he could do it at that point. She came down and says, I don't think he can get us off.
I don't think this is going to happen.
Well, we changed the plan then. I'd talked to Ratu on deck, and we decided to go for the second idea, which was to put a line down. As soon as we let her drift in, we lowered the life raft down.
As soon as it touched deck, one of the Fijians jumped out. He told me to come and get in. The Tui rocked back, and the raft took off, and I had my fingers in the outside of the cargo net. So up I shot with the raft. So my left hand started slipping off of the netting, and I looked up and he grabbed my hand like this, and there was this big Fijian hand, and I said, I'm okay. And then he reached over with his other hand and literally grabbed the back of my pants and just flung me over his shoulder into the raft, and then we were up at the top.
The other guys then had gone down below in the yacht to put him in a Johnson stretcher, which is a kind of a canvas stretcher we're stiffening on, and you can attach it with a rope at the top and the bottom.
I could have been killed easily during that period of time.
That's the way I felt. I really had more fear, I think, of the situation in the rescue than actually in the pitch pole.
Having finished with Destiny, we headed on south towards the beacon positions. The first one we went to was Heartlight.
I got to tell you, within 20 minutes of putting it on, they were there. And when they flew down, I mean, they were right over the wave top, so they flew by us. I got to tell you, it was a great sight.
It was the stuff movies is made out of.
They were not in great difficulty at that stage. About the same time as they found and identified the source of that beacon, we got yet another beacon. Again, it was the big search, what could it be? Initially, we thought it might be Quartermaster because it had been in the area.
For the southernmost yacht, Waikiki 2, the news from Kerikeri confirms the inevitable.
Waikiki 2, Waikiki 2, Kerikeri, copy.
Kerikeri, this is Waikiki 2, good evening.
Yes, good evening, John. Got you there, strength 3 and clear. Your next 24-hour, John, is much the same, unfortunately. Well, as you probably gathered, this, the position of that system, and it's going to go right over the top of you, in fact, tomorrow.
Roger, so we can't expect the system to have passed us until mid-afternoon tomorrow. Is that correct, over?
Yeah, that's affirmative.
We said to John, well, what do you reckon, can we get out of it? And he said, no, you haven't got a hope. He said, just batten down. His last words were good luck.
Really, this whole operation was not about search, it was about rescue. We basically knew where everything was. We had to define the positions, but we knew where they were. The big thing was how the heck we were going to get them off their vessel and into another one. So the process went on, how do we rescue Sophia?
The rescue centres found French Navy warship Jacques Cartier en route from Brisbane to Tauranga. Despite being 400 miles from Sophia, they'd been asked to attempt a rescue.
Donc nous avons reçu l'ordre de rallier le Sophia.
Then we received the order to join Sophia at maximum speed. The maximum speed of this vessel, a practical speed, is 14 knots. So we travelled at maximum speed to reach position, which required 2 days. And at one point we even received a call from the rescue centre in New Zealand asking us if we were travelling as fast as we could, as they were of the impression that every hour counted.
In the north, the Monowai at last has enough daylight to attempt to get Bill and Robin off Ramtha.
Monowai was still rolling very, very heavily, and I felt there was a very real danger of Monowai rolling onto the yacht and injuring or killing the people before they could scramble up the nets. I remember asking them if they were on the VHF, if they were fairly spry.
Real danger to life and limb. Are you both relatively spry?
It confused them for a while they tried to work out what I was talking about.
And I said to Bill, what's this the hell he means spry mean? What are we going to have to do?
Between the two of us, we would try to get as close as we could, and we would fire them a gun line.
Oh yes, sorry, we're just getting ourselves ready. We'll make our approach very shortly.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, we're not expecting to swim from there.
So the first one they actually fired, it actually hit the mast. I actually got it, and I had it cleated off trying to hold it in because the movement of the sea was just taking us both apart and together and whatever. And it actually snapped the line the first time.
Two or three times they nearly ran over us, not through their fault, but us trying to manoeuvre the sea's action. We've actually disappeared under the bows, you know, of the monowai.
The wind at the time was really, really strong. So it was really hard to judge whereabouts to fire the projectile, so it would go into the vicinity of the yacht, and after there was about five other shots, and I made the last shot, which was on our port side over here, to make it to the yacht, get it to. It wasn't an easy thing to do. So you're holding onto a guardrail here with this hand, you got a rifle over here, 70 odd knots of wind or whatever it was, and really, really bad rolling of the ship, and then try and make a shot at a yacht that was disappearing behind big swells at some stages. You couldn't see. 1 minute it was there, next minute it was gone. It was quite frightening.
Because I remember the expression on the lady's face, and she just was dying for that. You could just see she wanted that gun line over there so badly.
But anyhow...
She says, when you're happy, yeah, when you're happy, let us know.
Yeah. Anyhow, I got the line in the harnesses, and I put the first one on me, and Robin had just fallen over, so while she was sitting there, I just put the thing over her, and I went to straighten her up, and the monowai rolled that way, and we sort of got blown that way, and we got dragged down the deck, even before Robin had hers properly fitted.
It was under my arms. Yeah. It was enough to hold
me. Down the deck and over the lines, and Robin hit the staunchion, and it's bent the staunchion on the side there, and thrown into the water, straight into the water.
Straight in. It was like, phew, didn't have any consideration about going in.
Yeah, we were dragged into the water.
Stump, bow thruster, opposite.
They were just wrenched from the foredeck of the yacht straight under the water, and then was up to the seamen and surveyor workers on here, approximately 20 people, to pull this 200 metres of liner. And there was a very, very large wave, anything in excess of 15 metres. And we were the trough of this, and they were up on the peak. And you were actually looking up to these people as they were pulling the line in.
And that's when I was under, and I thought, no, I've got a life jacket on, I'll surface. Mm-hmm. And I came up and actually looked up. We were right in between the bows of the catamaran. So that was the first breath. And then the next thing we know, we're being dragged underwater.
Mrs. Forbes did spend a lot of time under the water, but I remember thinking that it would only be a minute or two before we got them on board, and we would just have to pump her out once we got her back. If they had fallen out of the harnesses, or if the rope had broken, then I don't think we'd have seen them again.
He's on!
And then when they're on board, I was even more relieved. Went up to her and we got on you. I'm so proud of you. I didn't even know this lady.
There was a tremendous sense of euphoria on the ship when Bill and Robin Forbes actually were landed into the ship. A spontaneous cheer and a round of applause broke out.
It was really pleasant to have someone say to me, you know, welcome to some Kiwi hospitality, yeah. As we were put, you know, sort of stood down onto the deck of the monoway.
But that would be a very long 3 minutes for those of us who were watching, and I would imagine for the Forbes as well.
The crews of Heartlight, Sophia and Silver Shadow await rescue, and they won't be the last. Quartermaster has still not... Daybreak, Monday, June 6th, the Hercules leaves Auckland. By midday, it reaches Silver Shadow, but communication's not easy.
Vessel is dismasted.
Okay, dismasted.
There are four POV.
Four POV, one with a broken arm.
One with a broken arm. The vessel cannot transmit on channel 16,
other than to get clicks.
But it can receive.
While they could hear us and they could acknowledge what we were saying to them, we had to communicate with them by a series, asking them for a series of transmissions, just short clicks on the radio, answering yes or no to the questions.
So they said to us, okay guys, 1 to 5, 5 being, you know, you're in danger, your lives are in danger. Just remember, we've got a lot of other boats out here that are breaking up, etc., etc. Give us a call, 1 to 5. We think we're a 2, and I think the call came back, hey, that's a pretty gutsy call. So we then had to ride that out. They said the Monowai and 2 other boats were steaming towards us, and we had to ride that out from that afternoon through the night and into round about 3 o'clock the following day. But that was the longest night of my life.
Freed up to search further, the Hercules makes a discovery which spells fresh hope for Quartermaster.
Kiwi 671, Wellington RCC, go ahead.
We were quite elated when we found the life raft, because life raft is very difficult to find in those sort of conditions. We picked it up through the electronic locator beacon that it had broadcasting and managed to home to it from a short range. And so when we actually saw the life raft first off, we thought, this is great, we've found them. And it took us about another 2 or 3 passes when we flew down to about 250 feet to actually determine that there was nobody in the life raft.
Kiwi 671, understand empty. Is the canopy up on the life raft, over?
Extremely difficult at that point to then refocus on, okay, well, where could the people who might have been in that raft, or is Quartermaster or the vessel from which this raft came still afloat somewhere else? How do we go about finding this? And it changes the priorities.
That's not very good, is it? The canopy was up. Canopy partially up, but tattered. How long
were
you searching for
this people in the water? We used maximum time that we could, while it was still daylight, after we found the life raft, to look for people in the water. A hopeless task, perhaps, because the visibility was so bad, but we had to give it a try. We had to try while it was still light.
We were obviously quite sad when we found that there was nobody in there. At that stage, though, I guess we still retained hope that that maybe the life raft had broken away from the yacht and that we may still find the yacht. So we did continue a search for the yacht itself, unsuccessfully.
But the storm they call a bomb has yet to complete its path of destruction. Waikiwi 2, waiting in the southern corner, is the next to feel its shattering force.
Waikiwi 2, Waikiwi 2, Kiri Kiri, roger, got you there loud and clear, go ahead.
Hello, John, sorry to be bothering you this part of the morning. Just like to know where we are,
Roger, I copy. So you've had 2 knockdowns.
We're talking about being hit by a truck.
At 70 miles an hour.
Whatever. It's for Kath and I, we're on our bunk, and all we feel is like boom, boom, into the wall. I know we're in the ceiling. We've got the bed on top of us. I remember saying to Kath, I think we've gone all the way this time, Kath, trying to remain cool, but she didn't hear it.
I just remember silence. And then there wasn't, in my mind, a question of whether we came up or not, which was interesting because I'd always had a little niggle in the back of my mind that, well, maybe that 7-ton keel won't really pull us back up again, but it did.
And I just had this sense that there's airflow in here, like there's wind in here and there's noise, and there was water at my feet. So suddenly, the world had changed.
The night before, the Orion, searching for Quartermaster, had spotted another yacht with no means of communication apart from some flares they'd been given.
At first I thought it was Star. Then I noticed it was Moving Star. And then he must have turned directly away from me, because then I saw this big bright, you know, the exhaust is what I was looking at. He managed to find some flares that Keith had given us. So we set those off.
We had nothing else at all on pilot, which is obvious later on because she didn't have anything else to give us. But I think it sort of raised our hopes a little bit, and also the hopes of the RCC that that might have been a quartermaster.
Another yacht.
We have. There's another yacht being found. It's to the north of the area, and it's been swamped, and it's in trouble.
Okay, look, let's put the P3 in there. We put the P3 in there. It's on its way there now. How far north is it?
Before Monowai got into the area and actually identified the yacht as pilot, we got another beacon.
Just. It's awful. Everything's sopped, everything's smeared, it stank. But also, that changed your attitude towards the boat a bit.
It was the beacon from Waikiwi 2. And the position of the beacon was well to the south of what we'd been the area we'd been operating in for the past couple of days. We had to decide then what we're going to do.
Soon after daybreak, the Orion brings Manawai to pilot, the yacht they'd spotted by chance.
So Craig popped out of the hatch and he turned around, or as he came out of the hatch, he said, Barbara, look at that rainbow. This huge 180 degree rainbow, really thick, bright colors, vivid. And so I turned around and we were both watching it, and then all of a sudden this great white ship was lifted right up into the center of it. It was the Manawai.
The ships.
Came up with pilot about 8:30 on the Sunday morning. The weather had moderated considerably, and there was still a large sea, so the ship was rolling reasonably heavy, but the wind had died down. Even so, we couldn't see the yacht with any certainty at distances of greater than half a mile, and we had to use the Orion flying over the top, and they would give us what we call an on top. They flew over the yacht, called when they're on top. We took the bearing and steam for it. We elected to send our rigid hull inflatable boat, the RIB, with a crew of three across to find out the identity and find out what assistance they required, of course.
We thought, we saw the ship, we thought, how are they going to get us now that they're here? What are we going to have to do to get to the ship? And then we saw that they had all of these small boats, and we thought, oh, are they going to be able to lower a small boat in the water? And sure enough, they had that RIB, which they put in the water.
Considering the size of the boat that we're in, and even though it's got a jet unit, it's quite maneuverable, the seas were just huge around us. And then I turned around to look for the ship, and the ship was gone. There was nothing there. So we were out there by ourselves as well. We left the ship, and we were given bearings to come right or left, and they were trying to direct us on. We couldn't see pilot from where we were. So I turned to my right and looked, and there was a huge wave, and the coxswain was looking to the left, and I was giving him a nudge. Look at this. And he went, oh, God. And brought the RIB round into it, and up and over we went and carried on. Got up alongside side it. The coxswain tried to get it as steady as possible, and I then moved up to the bow. The bowman held on to me. It just so happened when I jumped, I actually gave a little bit too much and fell right into the middle of the boat, right over the guardrails onto the top of the canopy. So it was good. At least I got over. I think once I got on there, I was scared. I was quite scared. You know, the adrenaline was really pumping. I had a plastic sheet that I was writing on, all the information, and I remember looking down at the sheet and trying to write, and I just couldn't. My hands were shaking. I think I was as scared as they were, actually.
It seemed to us kind of silly that he's there, that he immediately gets this paperwork out, and after all of that ordeal, but we were real glad to see him.
It wasn't up to me to offer assistance to them. This was passed to me by the command. It was up to them to ask for assistance and what they would like us to do for them. So basically, I was just trying to prompt them into that, and they wanted to get off rather quick.
Stand by.
I said, well, what do you want to do?
Wanted to make sure that
we
want to
get
right
off the boat. Will you take us?
Yeah. I just told them they could only take a few personal possessions, a small bag with clothes, and they were insisted on bringing these Colombian coffee beans with them.
And I wasn't about to just leave the boat out there and let somebody else take it. But more so that the idea of it being a hazard to navigation, so we decided that we would sink it before we left.
Greg was opening the seacock valves to flood the boat after we'd left it. The whole time that we were talking, this was going on, the rib was standing off just waiting for us to call them in.
As we're going to the Manawai, we were watching it and thinking about that, where it's going, and what, you know, everything that we've left behind.
We were coming back, and Greg was at the back on the port side, and the coxswain was in between Greg and Barbara, and I was beside Greg, and he was just so happy, just kept on hugging me, and just he was crying, and it was quite emotional. And I was going, oh dear.
The most dangerous part of the operation is in the recovery of the boat out of the water. So you get the tremendous pendulum effect when the ship's swinging and you just can't control the boat. So several times the boat came into reasonably heavy contact with the ship. But it wasn't too bad in the overall scheme of things. Everyone held on very, very tightly. There was certainly a lot of white knuckles, both in the boat and on the bridge.
Well, Roger, thank you. We're coming in.
The ship's.
Now it's time for the four aboard Heartlight to confront their saviour, New Zealand fishing trawler Santa Maru 18.
150-foot, 390-ton solid steel boat goes upwind of us and starts to drift down on us. And it's rocking in these waves. And all of a sudden, I'm looking up at these hulls as they tip up out of the water and tip down. And I'm saying, my God, if that thing tips down on top of it, it's just going to splinter and crush us. How in the world are we going to get from our boat onto that boat?
It was some time after they'd been disabled, and before the mysterious white light was seen further north, the realization came to a head for Diviana in a message from another dimension.
I wasn't told until 3 a.m. the following morning that we were in the center of this vortex and that it was going to go down there, period. And that it was going to be a beacon in the center of this vortex for Aetherian ships to come through. And she was also such an accumulation of my consciousness and Daryl's consciousness for 50 years of love and life that we had to get it off our back.
Diviana now refuses to leave her catamaran, which is not insured, until Captain Bruce White on the Santa Maru 18 promises to sink Heartlight at that very spot.
So the wind dies down,
yeah.
The waves die down, he comes up alongside of us and we start slapping up
like a baby
along the side of him.
And all of a sudden, this huge wave picked Heartlight up, carried her up in the air, and as she started to come down, it's like she settled out right next to that opening, and I just stepped off, and I said, hi, boys, good catch.
Officially, Heartlight breaks up, but in reality and with great reluctance, knowing the boat is still seaworthy, the trawler captain honors his promise, rams the catamaran, and sinks her at that spot. Later, Diviana is to tell her own story, Heartlight, rescue at sea.
Heartlight started to break up and in the end sunk.
Now, Manawai is preparing to rescue the crew of Silver Shadow, some 40 hours after they first rolled.
The captain speaking. At the moment, we're proceeding towards the yacht. We've got four people on board, one of whom is injured.
The sea conditions for the Silver Shadow rescue were horrendous, dreadful. In technical terms, I guess the sea or the swell was still running at 6 to 8 meters. The wind was down to about 45 knots, gusting up to about 55. This made the conditions for launching the rib not very good at all, at best marginal. Had we not got to them, or not come up with them by sunset, which was fairly early on in the evening, it was something like 17:20, then I would have had to think very much harder about whether to send the rib or not.
I saw Peter just lying there, and he had a scarf wrapped around him and a bit of duct tape, electrical duct tape. The guys on board done a real good job, and so we just had to strengthen it up a bit more with the duct tape roll, wrapped his shoulder up. That's where he was in severe pain, especially when he moved.
They got me out on the deck of Silver Shadow and put me over the lifelines so that when the tender came in close, they said, right, now when it gets in close, you know, we are going to push you into the tender, because there's no way with one hand that I could have got in by myself. So I was being held by two people. we got rid of our lifeline so that I was actually sitting on the deck. And then, after a number of tries, the two boats actually came together and they made the decision. Now, I knew that if I went down between those two boats, by God, I don't think I would have had much chance. I'd whipped weather gear on, I'd only had one arm, so it had to be right.
Here they go. Oh, big wave.
Come on, boys, hurry up.
I screamed when I hit the bottom of that tender.
Flying across Peter, trying to hold him down and also protect him, because there's no, all the waves just coming all over us. So just to help him breathe and stop him from nearly drowning.
And we came off one or two waves, and I can remember absolutely screaming because I was lying flat down on the boat and I was hurting pretty. I think I lost consciousness once or twice there. But
once I got him in the stretcher, it was just slow going, especially when we got airborne a few times and the whole stretcher came up off the ground and I was trying to hold Peter down. We both just went up in the air and dropped on the deck and he blacked out a little bit. Severe pain. And all the time I was telling him about this winching. He's probably going to get really hurt coming up on the side of the boat. Everything just went so smooth. The guys on top, down on the boat, connected them up and it just came up so smooth, like it was practiced thousands of times. It was the first time it's ever been done like that. And once we got him up, the other guys went up in the strops. We were wrapped.
Night has fallen when Keith and Ursula finally make contact with the Jacques Cartier. Sophia was the second boat to roll, and they've waited the longest of all, some 48 hours, for rescue. Now they too are about to face a whole new set of problems.
What made me anxious in this raging sea was that the mast or a rope would get caught in the screw propellers, and if both of these were blocked, we would not have been able to travel. The solution which we chose was to go and pick them up in the Zodiacs.
The first thing we did was launch the Zodiac. It wasn't a simple thing to do, because it was rolling a lot, so the launching attempts were difficult.
I think that it's then, in the end, that we felt, at least I did, most apprehensive, because we were waiting and we could see the conditions of the sea. We were going to launch the Zodiac, and before going down, it's true, there was a moment when I really wondered about the mission. If it was really, then I really realized the danger.
Eventually we sort of saw this little Zodiac in the distance, and it was up there and it was down there and it was all over the place.
I approached the ship about 10 times because as the sea was quite rough with waves of about 5 or 6 meters, we couldn't stay alongside the Sophia. There was too big a difference in height between the ship and the Zodiac.
All of a sudden, they were alongside, and one of the divers in a wetsuit flew through the air over the top of Ushi and landed in the cockpit.
As soon as it was time again to approach,
at the right time, I had to jump into the Zodiac.
La femme, l'estrayale était plus légère.
The woman, it's true, she was lighter. I pushed her into the Zodiac. And Jardin retrieved her below, took delivery of her. The man, first he had a stronger tie to his ship. I mean, he wanted to check everything, see that his ship was properly secured before leaving and so on.
I'd written on the main bulkhead in the saloon a note to Sophia saying, thank you for being such a beautiful lady. We'll be back for you.
He was anticipating salvaging the ship. I was anxious to get him on board, so we more or less had to tear him away from his ship. And then when he decided to jump, he didn't let go the rail. I mean, that when we pushed him, he didn't let go and slipped over the edge of the ship. He was hanging there, holding on to the rail. Then the Zodiac came closer, held him, I made him let go of the rail, using force because he was tense. The woman was screaming. It didn't help much.
Once the two survivors were on board the Jacques Cartier, we had to decide what we were going to do with the Sophia. Well, the Sophia was an abandoned ship, which could be a navigation hazard. I went to see Keith and Ursula in the sick bay and told them that we were going to request instructions from the rescue center about what to do about their ship. The order we received from the rescue center was to sink the Sophia.
He didn't want to have to tell me. And all I could do was actually accept and make it easier for him. He didn't want to have to tell me, he didn't want to have to do it. And the method of doing it was pretty abhorrent. I asked him how he was going to do it, and he said that they had a 20mm gun on board. And I really, what can you do? You just accept that.
When I told Keith this, I really felt that the ground had opened up beneath his feet. He said to me, that's all I have. If you destroy that ship, it will destroy a part of myself.
We shook hands as though it was neither of us wanted any part in it, but it had to be done.
So we asked the rescue center for confirmation that we really had to destroy the vessel, and they said in the end, if we fixed the GPS position accurately, that they would be able to issue a warning notice to navigators.
Sophia at that stage was reprieved, but not retrieved.
Waikiki 2's EPIRB is the last beacon still activated, and a Norwegian freighter, Nomadic Duchess, has agreed to attempt a rescue of Skipper John, his wife Kath, and their three sailing companions.
The most frightful time that we had was actually being against, with our 16-ton and their 35,000-ton, going up and down maybe 6 or so metres along their side and smashing into each other. Their boat was heeling backwards and forwards an alarming degree, and it had come crashing down on you, and you had to jump from our boat, which had no mast, no stanchions on that side, nothing to hold on to except down here, and every time it hit, it's sort of throwing you off balance, and somehow you had to time your jump at the top of a stroke when the boats were together, when the ladder was lined up, and make that leap. And if you missed, or if you did it at the wrong time, you were going to be sandwiched.
It was the first time in 5 days that we didn't have a beacon operating in the area. They got the beacon, they switched it off, and there was silence, electronic silence. It was great.
Our boat went underneath the back of their boat, which is a 35,000 ton, just started descending on the back of Waikiki. And so as she pulled out from underneath the transom area of the ship, the decking, the coach roof, had been smashed in a number of places with big gaping holes. At that stage, you could see it was only going to be a matter of a short time for breaking waves to go into the boat and eventually sink her.
The Orions and Hercules flew 117 hours. The Monowai attended over 98 hours. Beyond its normal call of duty, Kerikeri Marine Radio maintained continuous watch for 70 hours, and the rescue centre was activated for 103 hours.
The vessels in this case were well equipped in most cases. They were very well equipped. Those that had 406 beacons on, they made our job very easy. We knew what the target was from the word go. Those who had EPIRBs on board, we didn't know what the target was, but we knew where it was, and we could then find out. Those that didn't, that had no beacons on board, all I can say to them is they're very lucky. They were found by accident.
Thanks very much. If you set out to become a recluse and you make friends and you have family, then don't do it. Just have a bit of respect for the ones that will perhaps be left behind thinking about you and probably sparing their lives to even go and look for you.
Well, it keeps coming back to me, you know, why I keep asking why did it have to happen to us? We had because we'd always taken the right precautions and as far as the right routes and the right time of year, and I keep trying to make some kind of a meaning out of that. But then I remember that we weren't the only boat out there. There were 35 some boats out there at the time. And that there was unfortunately the crew of one boat never made it home, and with that then I just I forget about it and go about my business.
I've always been a person that's survived. I've been a survivor. I've been in never been in any situation like this before, and you don't really know until you're there. But I've always been one that could muddle through some way, whether it be that or just whether take charge if I had to. But like I say, you really don't know until you have to do it.
You know, Waikiri embodied so much for us. It had been our focus for two solid years. It had been the object of, you know, all our dreams and hopes and plans for the next 5 years. And it was the way that we were going to achieve so many different things. We were going to do, learn so much, see so much, experience heaps. Friends were going to be able to join us. Family was going to join us. And, travelling without a boat hasn't really got that appeal. It's no longer got it. The objective isn't there.
That was the experience that changed my life and my direction and what I'm going to be doing for the rest of this lifetime here in this incarnation, this life, this planet. I don't care how you want to word it.
Every day we wake up now, we are waiting for a phone call to say somebody sighted Sophia.
And here I can go and have a good cry. It was pretty bad. It really was.
Yep.
We got through it and we're lucky. I just feel sorry for those people that lost gear and lost their boats.
Yep.
Yeah. Lost everything.
Our dreams had been shattered.
Last incident, Maureen was fairly upset with the quartermaster because she felt that perhaps, you know, she could have done more. And we sat down together and we discussed it between us and said, well, you know, I explained knowing the weather side of it better than she did and probably a bit more sea experience too, because I've done more blue water sailing. We had to sit down and console ourselves. But I suppose that was made hard because it's the first lives we've lost in all the years we've been operating. And I guess that in itself is
Quartermaster, Kerikeri Radio calling. Do you copy?
Two weeks after Bill and Robin Forbes were rescued off Ramtha, another strange white light led an Orion to investigate. Ramtha was found intact, another yacht in the area, took it under tow to Tonga, and subsequently Bill and Robin completed their Pacific cruise. 3 months after Peter O'Neill and his crew abandoned it, Silver Shadow was located 600 miles to the north at Noumea, then lost again. A month later, it was found wrecked on a reef in Vanuatu, pillaged and unfit for salvage. And 6 months to the day after condemned Sophia was given its last-minute reprieve, it turned up 200 miles away and was returned to Keith and Ursula.
Look at that. Isn't that incredible? I've been looking for that all over the place.
Apart from the empty life raft, there have been no further sightings of Quartermaster, and to date, no wreckage has been found.
Since then, the HMNZS Monowai received a commendation from the American Congress. Flight Lieutenant Bruce Craze was awarded the Air Force Cross. Squadron Leader Michael Yardley, the Queen's commendation for valuable service in the air, and John and Maureen Cullen at Kerikeri Marine Radio were awarded the Queen's Service Medal.
The coxswain tried to get it as steady as possible, and I then moved up to the bow. The bowman held on to me. It just so happened when I jumped, I actually gave a little bit too much and fell right into the middle of the boat, right over the guardrails onto the top of the canopy. So it was good. At least I got over. I think once I got on there, I was scared. I was quite scared. You know, the adrenaline was really pumping. I had a plastic sheet that I was writing on all the information. And I remember looking down at the sheet and trying to write, and I just couldn't. My hands were shaking. I think I was as scared as they were, actually.
And it seemed to us kind of silly that he's there. That he immediately gets his paperwork out, and after all of that ordeal, but we were real glad to see him.
It wasn't up to me to offer assistance to them. This was passed to me by the command. It was up to them to ask us for assistance and what they would like us to do for them. So basically, I was just trying to prompt them into that, and they wanted to get off rather quick.
What do you want to do?
I wanted to make sure that we were all
right first.
We want
to get off the boat. Will you take us?
I just told them they could only take a few personal possessions, a small bag with clothes, and they insisted on bringing these Colombian coffee beans with them.
And I wasn't about to just leave the boat out there and let somebody else take it. But more so that the idea of it being a hazard to navigation, so we decided that we would sink it before we left.
Greg was opening the seacock valves to flood the boat after we'd left it. The whole time that we were talking, this was going on, the rib was standing off just waiting for us to call them in.
As we're going to the Manawai, we were watching it and thinking about that, where it's going, and what, you know, everything that we've left behind.
We were coming back, and Greg was at the back on the port side, and the coxswain was in between Greg and Barbara, and I was beside Greg, and he was just so happy, just kept on hugging me, and just he was crying, and it was quite emotional. And I was going, oh dear.
The most dangerous part of the operation is in the recovery of the boat out of the water. pendulum effect when the ship's swinging, and you just can't control the boat. So several times the boat came into reasonably heavy contact with the ship. But it wasn't too bad in the overall scheme of things. Everyone held on very, very tightly. There was certainly a lot of white knuckles, both in the boat and on the bridge.
My Roger, thank you. We're coming in.
The ships.
Starboard 20,
starboard 20.
It's after 10 o'clock, so it's now even cheaper to call anywhere in New Zealand with Telecom.
8:30 Thursday, Brad's new job.
Oh man, I'm gonna be awesome.
He is really going to his head.
Why don't I just throw him a parade? His head's so big, he could be afloat.
Home Improvement, 8:30 Thursday, part of the Big Night In on TV3.
Month, our customers will be saying thanks a million. 100 customers will get 100% off, and there's big discounts for everyone. This hot Panasonic stereo is now only $899, save $400. The Dome high-spec TV is only $469, save $180. Top brand, bottom price, a Panasonic video for only $469, save $180. And big savings on a big 29-inch TV and base, now only $2,498, save $900. It's time to say thanks a million, with discounts from 20 to 100%.
Like a highly tuned triathlete, today's advanced multi-valve engines face three challenges. For power, performance, and protection, Kestrel GTX3 with advanced three-way protection exceeds the challenge. Fast flow on startup. Protection for the driving force of your engine. Performance over the long run. Kestrel GTX3.
I recommend it for your next service.
Got that magic touch that makes me glow so much. It casts a spell, it rings a bell, the magic touch.
For life.
Every time you buy a can of Watties baked beans or a can of Watties spaghetti, you'll have the chance to win this. The amazing new Suzuki Vitara. Not only that, there's thousands of Watties product prizes to be won. And not only that, there's not one, but two Suzuki Vitaras to be won. Just look under the lids of these packs of Watties baked beans and spaghetti for your instant prize.
9 o'clock Thursday, is Murphy finally falling for Pete?
I don't think so.
Is the ice queen melting?
I'm sure nobody wants to hear the answer to that.
There's more than Bosnia on Murphy's mind. In Murphy Brown, 9 o'clock Thursday, part of the Big Night In on 3.
Now it's time for the four aboard Heartlight to confront their saviour. New Zealand fishing trawler Santa Maru 18.
150-foot, 390-ton solid steel boat goes upwind of us and starts to drift down on us. And it's rocking in these waves. And all of a sudden, I'm looking up at these hulls as they tip up out of the water and tip down. And I'm saying, my God, if that thing tips down on top of it, it's just going to splinter and crush us. How in the world are we going to get from our boat onto that boat?
It was some time after they'd been disabled, and before the mysterious white light was seen further north, the realization came to a head for Diviana in a message from another dimension.
I wasn't told until 3 a.m. the following morning
what we were in the center of this vortex and that it was going to go down there, period. And that it was going to be a beacon in the center of this vortex for Aetherian ships to come through. And she was also such an accumulation of my consciousness and Daryl's consciousness for 50 years of love and life that we had to get it off our back.
Liviana now refuses to leave her catamaran, which is not insured, until Captain Bruce White on the Santa Maru 18 promises to sink Heartlight at that very spot.
So the wind dies down,
yeah.
The waves die down. He comes up alongside of us and we start slapping up
like a baby
along the side of him.
And all of a sudden, this huge wave picked Heartlight up, carried her up in the air, and as she started to come down, it's like she settled out right next to that opening, and I just stepped off, and I said, hi, boys, good catch.
Officially, Heartlight breaks up, but in reality and with great reluctance, knowing the boat is still seaworthy, the trawler captain honors his promise, rams the catamaran, and sinks her at that spot. Later, Deviana is to tell her own story, Heartlight, rescue at sea.
Heartlight started to break up and in the end sunk.
Now, Monowai is preparing to rescue the crew of Silver Shadow, some 40 hours after they first rolled.
The sea conditions for the Silver Shadow rescue were horrendous, dreadful. In technical terms, I guess the sea or the swell was still running at 6 to 8 meters. The wind was down to about 45 knots, gusting up to about 55. This made the conditions for launching the rib not very good at all, at best marginal. Had we not got to them, or not come up with them by sunset, which was fairly early on in the evening, it was something like 17:20, then I would have had to think very much harder about whether to send the rib or not.
I saw Peter just lying there, and he had a scarf wrapped around him and a bit of duct tape, legible duct tape. The guys on board done a real good job, and so we just had to strengthen it up a bit more with the duct tape roll, wrapped his shoulder up. That's where he was in severe pain, especially when he moved.
They got me out on the deck of Silver Shadow and put me over the lifelines so that when the tender came in close, they said, right, now when it gets in close, we are going to push you into the tender, because there's no way with one hand that I could have got in by myself. So I was being held by two people. We got rid of our lifeline so that I was actually sitting on the deck. And then, after a number of tries, the two boats actually came together and they made the decision. Now, I knew that if I went down between those two boats, by God, I don't think I would have had much chance. I'd whip weather gear on, I'd only had one arm, so it had to be right.
Here they go. Oh, big wave.
Come on, boys, hurry up.
I screamed when I hit the bottom of that tender.
Flying across Peter, trying to hold him down and also protect him, because there's all the waves just coming all over us. So just to help him breathe and stop him from nearly drowning.
And we came off one or two waves, and I can remember absolutely screaming because I was lying flat down on the boat and I was hurting pretty. I think I lost consciousness once or twice there, but
once I got him in the stretcher, it was just slow going, especially when we got airborne a few times and the whole stretcher came up off the ground and I was trying to hold Peter down. We both just went up in the air and dropped on the deck and he blacked out a little bit. Severe pain. And all the time I was telling him about this winching, he's probably going to get really hurt coming up on the side of the boat. Everything just went so smooth. The guys on top, down on the boat, connected them up and it just came up so smooth, like it was practiced thousands of times. It was the first time it's ever been done like that. And once we got him up, the other guys went up in the strops. We're wrapped.
Night has fallen when Keith and Ursula finally make contact with the Jacques Cartier. Sophia was the second boat to roll, and they've waited the longest of all, some 48 hours, for rescue. Now they too are about to face a whole new set of problems.
What made me anxious in this raging sea was that the mast or a rope would get caught in the screw propellers, and if both of these were blocked, we would not have been able to travel. The solution which we chose was to go and pick them up in the Zodiacs.
The first thing we did was launch the Zodiac. It wasn't a simple thing to do, because it was rolling a lot, so the launching attempts were difficult.
I think that it's then, in the end, that we felt, at least I did, most apprehensive, because we were waiting and we could see the conditions of the sea. We were going to launch the Zodiac, and before going down, it's true, there was a moment when I really wondered about the mission. If it was really, then I really realized the danger.
Eventually, we sort of saw this little Zodiac in the distance, and it was up there, and it was down there, and it was all over the place.
I approached the ship about 10 times, because as the sea was quite rough, with waves of about 5 or 6 meters, we couldn't stay alongside the Sophia. There was too big a difference in height between the ship and the Zodiac.
All of a sudden, they were alongside, and one of the divers in a wetsuit flew through the air over the top of Ushi and landed in the cockpit.
As soon as it was time again to approach in the right time, I had to jump into the Zodiac.
The woman, it's true, she was lighter. I pushed her into the Zodiac, and Jardin retrieved her below, took delivery of her. The man, first he had a stronger tie to his ship. I mean, he wanted to check everything, see that his ship was properly secured before leaving and so on.
I'd written on the main bulkhead in the saloon a note to Sophia saying, thank you for being such a beautiful lady. We'll be back for you.
He was anticipating salvaging the ship. I was anxious to get him on board, so we more or less had to tear him away from his ship. And then when he decided to jump, he didn't let go the rail. I mean, that when we pushed him, he didn't let go and slipped over the edge of the ship. He was hanging there, holding on to the rail. Then the Zodiac came closer, held him, I made him let go of the rail, using force because he was tense. The woman was screaming. It didn't help much.
Once the two survivors were on board the Jacques Cartier, we had to decide what we were going to do with the Sophia. Well, the Sophia was an abandoned ship, which could be a navigation hazard.
We
went to see Keith and Ursula in the sick bay and told them that we were going to request instructions from the rescue center about what to do about their ship. The order we received from the rescue center was to sink the Sophia.
He didn't want to have to tell me. And all I could do was actually accept and make it easier for him. He didn't want to have to tell me, he didn't want to have to do it. And the method of doing it was pretty abhorrent. I asked him how he was going to do it, and he said that they had a 20 millimeter gun on board, and I really, what can you do? You just accept that.
When I told Keith this, I really felt that the ground had opened up beneath his feet. He said to me, that's all I have. If you destroy that ship, it will destroy a part of myself.
Une partie de lui-même, quoi, en fait.
We shook hands as though it was neither of us wanted any part in it, but it had to be done.
Donc nous avons redemandé confirmation au centre de...
So we asked the rescue centre for confirmation that we really had to destroy the vessel, and they said in the end, if we fixed the GPS position accurately, that they would be able to issue a warning notice to navigators.
Un avis donnant un avis de vigilance au navigateur.
Sophia at that stage was reprieved, but not retrieved.
Thursday on NYPD Blue.
I did what I did, and I'm ready to go away for it.
John takes the stand.
My people will give you $100K for an exclusive interview.
I don't want you testifying anymore.
Stirring old emotions.
I still have feelings for her.
I love you.
But is love enough?
I hope to have something to say to you soon on a personal matter.
To protect you.
You're a liar!
In the real world.
Police!
Of NYPD Blue, part of the Big Night In, 9:30 Thursday on TV3.
I suppose there's a bit of glamour in my job, but I'll tell you, there's a bunch of school leavers in our country who'd say there'd be a bit of glamour in any job if they could just get one. That's why at TV3 we're supporting Job Intro. We're giving three job seekers 3 weeks workplace experience. If you work somewhere, give your boss a wriggle on tomorrow, because chances are your workplace could do the same.
We're not asking you to employ someone, and we're not asking you to pay them. We're just asking you to give them some workplace experience. Phone us now.
We get all types in here. So it is good that creamy natural yoplait comes in so many flavors to please so many people with so many yoplait flavors. Life is never done.
Yoplait. It's French for yogurt.
Brand you wear for life.
Mark, the parcel from home, mate.
Ah, thank you, Mr. Robert.
Okay.
My dearest Mark, we've all missed you while you've been at camp, so I've sent you some farm bake. Your Nana says they're just like she used to make, so make sure you share them around.
Made the traditional way, with the finest quality ingredients, there's always plenty to share with Farm Bake.
Arnott's Farm Bake, the taste of home.
When you're painting something this size, it's hard to choose the right color from something this size. That's why Resene Paint's test pots cover an area this size. Choose from over 900 colors at your Resene color shop.
Melrose Place, the place to be, returning soon to TV3.
Tonight, tensions run high in Whanganui as Māori are told they have 7 days to remove all structures and leave Maltoa Gardens. Protesters warn that the Whanganui District Council will be to blame if things turn violent. That story shortly on Nightline.
Waikiki 2's EPIRB is the last beacon still activated, and a Norwegian freighter, Nomadic Duchess, has agreed to attempt a rescue of Skipper John, his wife Kath, and their three sailing companions.
The most frightful time that we had was actually being against, with our 16-tonne and their 35,000-tonne, going up and down maybe 6 or so metres along their side and smashing into each other. Their boat was heeling backwards and forwards, an alarming degree, and it had come crashing down on you, and you had to jump from our boat which had no mast, no stanchions on that side, nothing to hold on to except down here. And every time it hit, it's sort of throwing you off balance. And somehow you had to time your jump at the top of a stroke when the boats were together, when the ladder was lined up, and make that leap. And if you missed, or if you did it at the wrong time, you were going to be sandwiched.
It was the first time in 5 days that we didn't have a beacon operating in the area. They got the beacon, they switched it off, and there was silence, electronic silence. It was great.
Our boat went underneath the back of their boat, which is a 35,000 ton, just started descending on the back of Waikiki. And so as she pulled out from underneath the transom area of the ship, the decking, the coach roof, had been smashed in a number of places with big gaping holes. At that stage, you could see it was only going to be a matter of a short time for breaking waves to go into the boat and eventually sink her.
The Orions and Hercules flew 117 hours. The Monowai attended over 98 hours. Beyond its normal call of duty, Kerikeri Marine Radio maintained continuous watch for 70 hours, and the rescue centre was activated for 103 hours.
The vessels in this case were well equipped in most cases. They were very well equipped. Those that had 406 beacons on, they made our job very easy. We knew what the target was from the word go. Those who had EPIRBs on board, we didn't know what the target was, but we knew where it was, and we could then find out. Those that didn't, that had no beacons on board, all I can say to them is they're very lucky. They were found by accident.
Thanks. If you set out to become a recluse and you make friends and you have family, then don't do it. Just have a bit of respect for the ones that will perhaps be left behind thinking about you and probably sparing their lives to even go and look for you.
Well, it keeps coming back to me, you know, why I keep asking, why did it have to happen to us? We had because we'd always taken the right precautions and as far as the right routes and the right time of year, and I keep trying to make some kind of a meaning out of that. But then again, I remember that we weren't the only boat out there. There were how many 35 some boats out there at the time. And that there was unfortunately the crew of one boat never made it home, and with that then I just I forget about it and go about my business.
I've always been a person that's survived. I've been a survivor. I've been in never been in any situation like this before, and you don't really know until you're there. But I've always been one that could muddle through some way, whether it be that or just whether take charge if I had to. But like I say, you really don't know until you have to do it.
You know, Waikiki embodied so much for us. It had been our focus for two solid years. It had been the object of, you know, all our dreams and hopes and plans for the next 5 years. And it was the way that we were going to achieve so many different things. We were going to do, learn so much, see so much, experience heaps. Friends were going to be able to join us. Family was going to join us. And, travelling without a boat hasn't really got that appeal. It's no longer got it. The objective isn't there.
That was the experience that changed my life and my direction and what I'm going to be doing for the rest of this lifetime here in this incarnation, this life, this planet. I don't care how you want to word it.
Every day we wake up now, we are waiting for a phone call to say somebody sighted Sophia.
And
here I can go and have a good cry. It was pretty bad. It really was.
Yep.
We got through it and we're lucky. I just feel sorry for those people that lost gear and lost their boats.
Yep.
Lost everything.
Our dreams had been shattered.
Last incident, Maureen was fairly upset with the quartermaster because she felt that perhaps, you know, she could have done more. And we sat down together and we discussed it between us and said, well, you know, I explained knowing the weather side of it better than she did, and probably a bit more sea experience too, because I've done more blue water sailing. We had to sit down and console ourselves, but I suppose that was made hard because it's the first lives we've lost in all the years we've been operating. And I guess that in itself is...
Quartermaster, Kirikiri Radio calling, do you copy?
Two weeks after Bill and Robin Forbes were rescued off Ramtha, another strange white light led an Orion to investigate. Ramtha was found intact. Another yacht in the area took it under tow to Tonga, and subsequently Bill and Robin completed their Pacific cruise. 3 months after Peter O'Neill and his crew abandoned it, Silver Shadow was located 600 miles to the north at Noumea, then lost again. A month later, it was found wrecked on a reef in Vanuatu, pillaged and unfit for salvage. And 6 months to the day after condemned Sophia was given its last-minute reprieve, it turned up 200 miles away and was returned to Keith and Ursula.
Look at that. Isn't that incredible? I've been looking for that all over the place.
Apart from the empty life raft, there have been no further sightings of Quartermaster, and to date, no wreckage has been found.
Since then, the HMNZS Monowai received a commendation from the American Congress. Flight Lieutenant Bruce Craes was awarded the Air Force Cross. Squadron Leader Michael Yardley, the Queen's Commendation for Valuable Service in the Air, and John and Maureen Cullen at Kerikeri Marine Radio were awarded the Queen's Service Medal. As the pace of living increases, we rely on prepared foods more, but is our lifestyle exposing us to the risk of food poisoning?
Next Wednesday on Inside New Zealand, an in-depth look at what we're putting in our mouths.
Hope she got the hand-washing message.
Why has the incidence of crippling and sometimes fatal food poisoning trebled in the past 10 years? Why does half of all food poisoning occur in our own home?
Ugh, I'm not coming to your house for dinner if you do this.
Most importantly, what's being done to raise hygiene standards in this country?
It's enough to make you sick. Next week on Inside New Zealand, join us again then. Have a good week. I'm Neil Walker. Good night.